company and two of them. I'm not nervous though because Jen is so loud.
Yeah.
In a good way. Like,
yeah. And the video is going to be loud. Yeah. So it's not just for that. Yeah.
Well, good morning, everybody. I hate to interrupt, but I think we do need to get started here. I'm Pastor Thom. I want to welcome everybody who's in the sanctuary and our video audience as well. It's good having you. What do we have for announcements, Jenna?
Recorded words that Jesus ever said were, "Did you not know that I must be in my Father's house?" And then before he left this earth, he told his disciples, "I'm going to prepare a place for you in Father's house." Well, what if we didn't have to wait to be in Father's house? What if there was more?
In my journey with Father God, I realized that I had a lot of head knowledge about him, but I didn't really know him. And it felt like he was disappointed in me all the time. No matter how hard that I tried, no matter how many boxes that I checked, it just felt like it wasn't enough, and it felt like I wasn't enough. You know, there was a little girl that was living inside of me that was still living out all of the messages that I'd picked up in my childhood. And I was terrified that people were going to find out that I wasn't who they thought I was. When I encountered my Heavenly Father, I discovered that I actually could have a real relationship with Him, and where it wasn't just about me being enough, it was that He was actually enough.
This study is going to unpack our beliefs about Father God, about ourselves, and even about our religious beliefs. You are lavishly loved, and we hope you can repeat this with us. Say it with us, that you're lavishly loved and that you're fully forgiven.
Rachel and I have done this study with literally hundreds of women, and we have discovered that women everywhere are just like us. They're still living out the messages that they picked up as little girls. They want to rest, they just don't know how.
We're going to walk you through scripture to undo the lies that have prevented you from encountering God.
I really hope that everybody has had a fresh revelation of who you really are.
Do you feel like you're missing something? Do you long to experience God for yourself?
Wherever you are on the journey, we invite you into more. We invite you into an adventurously expectant life within the doors of Father's house.
Come and join us on this journey to Father's house.
church to gather together. It was the Ith gathering. We had 51 women from 10 different church communities in the area, and it was a wonderful time. So make sure if you see it again or see another gathering, you should so come join us. It was a wonderful time. So yes, thank you, Deb, for organizing that, you and Jimmy, and it was just wonderful. So if you would please join us, stand, and we're going to sing. Don't forget your connect cards. I forgot that. So fill out your connect cards. So much to talk about today.
Lost without hope, of no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. And my orphan heart was given. I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was ransomed, he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt, and he called me his friend. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes
as though heaven had lost.
But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. For your grace so free washes over. You have made me new.
arrested and my life began.
When death was arrested
and my life began.
When death was arrested
and my life began.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing.
Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe.
We live for you.
Oh,
we live for you.
Jesus, the name above every other name.
Jesus, the only one who could ever sing.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe.
We live for you.
We live for you.
Jesus, the only one who could ever say.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe.
We live for you.
Oh, we live for you.
Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in one.
Please join me responsibly in our call to worship. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear?
The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
If we're not afraid, then we will seek to live bold Christian lives.
We will seek to live in the presence of God,
knowing that we can trust God in all things.
Let us praise and worship God, the one who keeps us safe and gives us strength to proclaim His word to the world.
Please join me in our opening prayer.
Holy God, we need you. We need your love, your grace, and your unending mercy. We need to know your truth, to experience your peace. God, we need your guidance and your wisdom. We need your strength. God, we need all of these things, and we know that you can give us all that we need. But God, let us never pursue only the things that you can give. As we worship you this morning, remind us of our need to take up our crosses and deny ourselves. Give us the desire to lose our lives so that we can gain eternal life. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated.
When we continue on a time of prayer, let's bow our heads as we pray the prayers of celebration and care. Gracious, merciful, caring God, Lord, we lift up to you all those who are on our prayer list, who are hurting, whether it's physically, spiritually, emotionally, mentally, whatever it may be. Lord, you know their concerns, you know their pain, you know their sufferings. We also lift up to you those unspoken concerns, worries, stresses, physical things, whatever may be going on in the lives of those who have not shared with us through our prayers of celebration and care list, Lord. There's people in this congregation, as you know, God, there's people who will be watching who are struggling in their lives. And we pray for them, and we pray that they would not only experience your presence in their lives, but they'd also sense your peace, the kind of peace that the world can't give to them, and that you would remind them that you're along that journey with them each and every step of the way. We want to acknowledge and lift up into prayer this morning the Ukrainian people and the Ukrainian government. Lord, we pray for those people that you would give them whatever they need, resources, whatever it may be. And we pray that the war would end, that you would have a hand in that and in that. In this day and age, Lord, you know what it's like for us. And you know we don't like war any more than you do. And so we pray for an end to it. And we pray for those people in the Ukraine that that they would be given the resources that they need to survive today, and that they would also know your peace, and to know that even though they may not understand, just like we don't understand why this is happening, but we do understand and know that you are in the midst of that and with them. And so again, Lord, we pray for peace in their lives. Lord, we pray all of this in Jesus' name, the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This morning's scripture, not that we need any more, the ones we've had have been awesome, so let's continue.
Please stand and join us.
Thank you. Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm.
Please be seated. Our scripture comes from the Gospel of Luke chapter 9, and I'll be reading verses 21 through 27. He sternly ordered and commanded them not to tell anyone, saying, "The Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised." Then he said to them all, "If any want to become my followers, let him deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will save it. What does it profit them if they gain the whole world but lose or forfeit themselves? Those who are ashamed of me and my words, of them the Son of Man will be ashamed when he comes in his glory and the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. But truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God." Here is the reading of God's holy word. I'd like to invite the children to come up for a few minutes. You're trying, right? That's okay. All right, good morning, everybody. Oh, that is so sad. I'm sorry. The first service, we had like 8 kids, and they were like, I mean, I thought the police were going to come because they're so loud. You ready? Should we try it again? Good morning.
Good morning.
Excellent. That was awesome. Okay, so does everybody know what the word selfish means? Most of you know what selfish means, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me ask you this. Have you ever been selfish?
No.
Remember, you're in church.
No.
I'm going to guess and say that not only all of us sitting up here have been selfish, I'm going to pretty much guarantee everybody here in these pews have been selfish. Everybody watching online has been selfish. I think most of us have been selfish. Yeah, I think pretty much everybody on earth has, for the most part, been selfish at some point, right?
No, I haven't.
You haven't?
Probably when I was a baby, though.
Probably when you were a baby?
Yeah.
You know, your mom and dad are sitting right there.
Yes, I know that.
Okay. It's hard, though. It's hard not to be selfish sometimes, isn't it? I mean, if you get a bag of candy, especially certain kinds of chocolate, you want to keep it to yourself, don't you?
Yeah, I want those Twix.
Right? And do your parents make you share it? Yeah, that's the right thing to do. Does anybody have any candy at home right now?
A bunch from Halloween.
Bunch? So I'm thinking you should...
At least my house sends a whole bucket of candy to Texas.
That's nice. You know what I think? For those of you who have a bunch of candy, you should show that you're not selfish by bringing some to Pastor Thom next Sunday.
I already gave you some of mine.
You did. You don't like that idea?
I already did.
Well, let me tell you this. Jesus tells us that we should deny ourselves. And what Jesus is saying is that we shouldn't be selfish, right? We should be selfless, right? And we should give to other people and share with other people, even if it means us not having something, right? So if you have one chocolate, you give the one chocolate to somebody else, right? Is that easy? Would that be easy to do?
No.
No.
I have 1,000 pieces of candy. I'll just eat them out.
Yeah.
Keep one to me.
Keep one to you? That's good. Would you?
But if somebody didn't get one, I would split it in half.
You know what I think I should do?
What?
I think I should close in prayer. What do you think? I'm going to pray now. Is that a good idea?
Yes.
Or do you guys just want to hang out up here?
Yeah.
Hang out.
Okay. You don't want to go back? Okay.
I want to hang out right here.
Can you pray and then do this and we can still hang out here?
Yeah.
Yeah.
How about I pray, I give you a sucker, and you head back?
No, I'm staying here.
Well, what I start? Let's just start with the prayer part first, okay? Then we'll work our way, okay? Loving God, Lord, I thank you for every child up here. And Lord, as always, I ask your blessings on each one of them. And I pray that they can learn to be as selfless as possible, just like I pray that we can all be as selfless as possible so we can be more like Jesus. We pray all this in his name. Amen. Okay, ladies first. Oh, slow down. Slow down, ladies. Remember what happened before. Whoa. Oh, that was close. That was close. Oh. There he goes again. Okay. We got one more lady. Oh, we got another lady. Oh, and there's another. You want to grab one for your sister? Yeah. Okay. All right, now the rest of the girls. Nobody, you guys didn't catch it, did you?
I'm staying here.
No, you better head back. I think your mom or dad might have something you said about that. Yeah. Okay. For those of you who may have watched or listened or were here last Sunday, you'll notice that the scripture that I'm using, I actually referenced last Sunday, right? And the more I thought about it, I thought this is a great one to begin the Lenten season because it is a passage that causes us to really do some self-reflecting. And that is really a lot about what the Lenten season is really about, right? Is doing some self-reflecting. And this passage helps us kick off and do some of that with. Even though it's a hard passage, because it does point out the cost of discipleship. And when we're talking about cost of discipleship, those passages are usually a little bit more difficult to digest. I also want to share with you, I don't know if you noticed these smaller crosses up here, and they're kind of scattered throughout the church. The Sunday school kids made those for us, and we're going to be adding something new to the scene every Sunday leading up to and including Easter Sunday. And since we're talking about bearing crosses, it was just very appropriate then that we have all these smaller crosses representing our crosses that we're called to carry. Okay? All right, so you see the screen, the Jeffersons. Can you go ahead and play that video?
Well, we're moving on.
Yeah, Jenna's getting down over there. Yeah, right? That's good. I think we get the point. So raise your hand if you remember that. Okay, raise your hand if you're about somewhere around that 35, 40 year age and you don't remember that. Okay, that's what I thought. Have you ever seen reruns though? I mean, you've never, right? Okay. You guys missed out on an awesome show, by the way. Huh? George Jefferson was the man. Not really, but he thought he was the man in the show. As you heard that theme song, you know, the Jeffersons were moving on up, right? That's how the song goes. And by definition, what we would say today is the Jeffersons were experiencing upward mobility. That by definition is what they were going through, which is really rising in either economic or social status or position, right? That's what upward mobility is. And they really, you can, if you watch the show, you hear references to it all the time. They really went from rags to riches because of, and for those of you who don't know the show, because of George Jefferson's dry cleaning business and how it just flourished. And that allowed them to move up the social and economic scale. And they ended up living the good life, the really good life. You know, one of the things, actually the only thing, this is the truth, the only thing I remember about my sociology class in college was this concept of upward mobility, what the Jeffersons experienced. And the reason why I remember that, and I can even remember sitting in the classroom having this conversation, the light coming on in my head, because I experienced it personally. You know, growing up, we were very poor. We didn't have really anything. And in fact, there's times we didn't have food. So when I was sitting in college in class, I realized, man, even though I really hadn't come a long way, but I had come a long way in comparison, right? I always had food on the table, a warm place to live. And I'm thinking, yeah, this is the good life, right? And so I experienced that upward mobility. And I can remember being appreciative of that concept. And the reason why I share all of this with you this morning is because this was really part of the expectations of the people of the time when it comes to the Messiah, including the disciples, by the way. Most of you know that they believed that the Messiah would come down, he'd sit on this earthly throne and rule, and all the people's lives would be better than what they were in the past. They expected that they'd be moving on up to this good life, that life would be this really comfortable and easy life when the Messiah came. That is what they expected. They expected this kind of a sense of this upward mobility when Jesus arrives, or the Messiah arrives. But what does Jesus say in Scripture? He tells the disciples that he's going to die, and on the third day he's going to rise again. He also tells them that if the disciples are going to follow him, if they're really going to follow him, they're going to have to deny themselves, and they're going to have to take up their own crosses. Every time I read this passage, a thing pops in my mind, and I just wonder how far the disciples' jaws dropped when they heard Jesus saying this. Because this had to be absolutely devastating to them. Right? They expected the good life, and now here Jesus is saying, deny yourself and carry your cross. I mean, their expectations to be a little off, I totally get, but with these two major extremes, they had to have been just absolutely shocked. They honestly thought that Jesus was going to usher in this Jefferson-type comfortable lifestyle here on earth for all of humanity, and Jesus is clearly telling them in this morning scripture that they're wrong, that they're mistaken. Instead of moving on up, they're going to have to deny themselves, which would mean for them to set aside all their relationships, which means not just friends, but family as well, to forgo whatever life they had beforehand. They would really, in a lot of ways, have to let go of their prior identity. And instead, selflessly put their identity completely into Jesus Christ. And then they'd also have to bear their cross, right? As if they're going to be crucified every single day. All this if they're to follow Jesus. You know, I feel very fortunate that we live in the time we do, for the sole fact that we know the rest of the story, right? Those disciples didn't know the rest of the story. They couldn't comprehend. In fact, they'd falter and they'd think they knew and, you know, go back and forth. And at one point, Peter denies Jesus three times, right? We know those stories. But we can look back with very clear 20/20 vision, and we can see this bigger picture. And we know the purposes of Jesus' death. We know that through his death on that degrading, horrific cross, that we are freed from the bondage of our sin and we are saved. We know that, right? We get that. So unlike the disciples, we really don't have any misunderstandings of why Jesus had to die. And we also, for the most part, understand what it means to deny ourselves and to take up our crosses, don't we? I want to share a little bit about that with you, though. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, in a sermon that he preached on self-denial, he said this. He said, denying or refusing to follow our own will from a conviction that the will of God is the only rule of action to us, and we see the reason because we are creatures, because it is He that had made us and not we ourselves. The will of God is a path leading straight to God. The will of man, which once ran parallel with it, is now another path. Not only different from it, but in our present state, directly contrary to it. It leads from God. And if, therefore, we walk in the one, we must necessarily quit the other. We cannot walk in both. Indeed, a man of faint heart and feeble hands may go in two ways, one after the other, but he cannot walk in two ways at the same time. He cannot at one and the same time follow his own will and follow the will of God. He must choose the one or the other, denying God's will to follow his own or denying himself to follow the will of God. John Wesley, I think, makes it very clear that we can't follow both, right? And that denying ourselves, we have to let go of our will in favor of God's will. Now, when we talk about the cross, when we talk about taking up our own crosses, we're really talking about commitment here. It's having the commitment to put God's will above a person's own while living in a very me-centric, a very I-oriented kind of world that we live in. It's the kind of a commitment where a person is willing to take up a cross and really be willing to die for the sake of the gospel. That's commitment. To deny oneself and take up their cross is really to put one's own will on the shelf. It's putting aside their selfish ambitions. It's putting aside their expectations, their desires, and instead focusing their lives on being a disciple of Jesus Christ, no matter what the cost may be. Whether it's money, whether it's time, whether it's security, whether it's the comforts of life. It's also very much so, when we talk about denying ourselves and taking up our crosses, it's also an expression of our sincere and genuine faith in Jesus Christ, right? Theologian Roger Van Horn, writing about this passage, and I have another one I'm going to share with you from theologian John Nolan, but Roger Van Horn says this about this passage. He says, if we believe the gospel, there's no escaping from denying ourselves and taking up a cross. That's what following Jesus is all about. It's about living the Christ life in the world. Heeding a friend's call for help, looking for ways to improve the community, join with others through our church to support mission ministries, being sensitive to those with special needs, inviting a friend to join you in a Bible study, starting a Bible study or joining a Bible study for yourself, doing all those things that take us out of our comfort zones, our preoccupations with ourselves and those we love, and focusing on the call of God to be in service to God and others. And John Nolan, he says this. He says, to follow Jesus is to be called to a radical denial of self-interest and concern for their own natural well-being. Wow. He goes on to say that such a radical commitment is not one that is called for only in some crisis situations, but one that needs to be renewed daily and one that needs to be undergirded in all that happens in our daily lives. The call, he says, is to a practical denial of our natural inner drive to self-preservation and care for our own interests. So, rhetorical questions. Do we like to be taken out of our comfort zones? I'm going to guess and say most of us do not. We like comfort. We like easy. I mean, we strive for it. Another question, do we like the idea of radical denial or self-interest? Probably not, is my guess. We don't like to deny ourselves. We like creature comforts. We like to do what we want, when we want, how we want, right? You know, the truth of our faith can be really hard. That's a fact. Being a disciple of Jesus Christ can be very hard, especially considering that it calls for a lifestyle of self-sacrifice, which we don't inherently like. We prefer the Jeffersons lifestyle, don't we? But this is what Jesus calls us to. There's another thing I want to touch on. It's probably as important, perhaps maybe even more important than what I've already shared this morning. In this morning's scripture, Jesus also says this. He says, for those who want to save their life will lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake will find it. And he says, for what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their lives? This statement emphasizes the previous comments that Jesus made. It kind of brings it home. But it also points to something else. It also points us to some, what I think is phenomenally great news, and it's news we've heard before. This one little statement reminds us that by following Jesus, we gain eternal life. We gain eternal life through following Jesus Christ. Our commitment as disciples of Jesus is never in vain. By sacrificing in this life for Jesus Christ, we gain eternal life, and there's nothing that this world can ever offer us that can come close to, even remotely close, to compare to that. And so is it really sacrifice sometimes? You know, understanding that being a disciple in the world we live in, understanding that that's not a simple task, and knowing full well that there's a lot of things in this world that do distract us from our faith, I still sincerely believe that if we're committed, and really with the help of the Holy Spirit always, right? If we're committed and with the help of the Holy Spirit, we can continue to be, or perhaps continue to grow into being, self-denying, cross-bearing disciples who are focused on God's will and not the things of this world. And finally, let me just say this. As those self-denying, cross-bearing disciples of Jesus Christ, you and I are guaranteed, we are assured of, we can bank on our eternal salvation. Amen. Let's bow our heads in prayer. God, you are a very merciful, gracious, wonderful, compassionate God. And Lord, without your mercy, without Jesus Christ, we would be a lost people. Lord, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for his sacrifice. And we pray that we can emulate his lifestyle by living a sacrificial, selfless life, denying ourselves, carrying our crosses, reaching out to those, and being a beacon of light to those who need a beacon of light. We pray all of this in Jesus's very holy and very precious name. Amen. Let's just take a brief moment of time of reflection. All right, at this time we'll be celebrating Holy Communion. And before we get into the liturgy, I do have a few things that I'd like to share with you. First of all, you don't have to be United Methodist to participate in the Lord's Supper. You're more than welcome and invited to participate. If you don't want to come forward, just let the ushers know, raise your hand or whatever as they're heading down, and they'll bring communion to you in one of the little packets. Also, we do have little packets up here. We also have elements for those of you who may have gluten issues. And then also we use the intinction method, so we have one cup, you'll receive a piece of bread. Just take that, dunk it just a little bit into the juice. That would be great. I will be standing over here, and Levi will be standing over here by the piano, should you want somebody to be praying for you after you receive communion. And then you can head back to your pews through the side aisles. And I think that's pretty much it for the announcements. Okay. So let's go ahead and join together, and we'll read this responsively. And every once in a while, I like to remind us, let's read this slowly, right? And think about what we're saying, and even what we're hearing each other, because these are very powerful words, and I never want things to just become routine or mundane. I want us to think about and contemplate what we're saying and what we're hearing. So join with me. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. By your incarnation, life, suffering, execution, and resurrection, Lord, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery and made a new covenant with us by water and the Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, he gave thanks to you. He broke the bread, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup. Again, he gave thanks to you. He gave it to his disciples. He said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, Lord, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of our faith, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us who are gathered here. Pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and juice. Lord, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. And by your Spirit, make us one with Christ, make us one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. I'd like to ask the communion stewards to come up, please. After they've received communion, the ushers will escort the rest of you up so that you get the opportunity as well. Body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you.
You called me out upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail. And there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stay. My soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Your grace abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you've never failed, and you won't start now. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours and you are mine. without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. And Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. And Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior.
Lucky I got to hear her in the first service too, right? Absolutely phenomenal, and I can't thank you enough for sharing that incredible gift you have. I told the first service I'm really kind of in trouble because I volunteered to do special music next Sunday, and obviously that is not going to hold a candle to that. So, yeah. It sounded like the real recording. I mean, except for Bob's piano playing. You'll get me back next Sunday now, right? All right, let's stand and join in singing our song of sending, Build Your Kingdom Here.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray, unveil why remain.
Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now.
We are your church. We need your power in us.
We seek
your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. We feel
to see the captives' hearts.
hurt, the sick, the poor, at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are your church. We pray, revive this earth.
Build your kingdom here.
Let the darkness hear. Show your heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire. Bring this nation back.
Change the
atmosphere. Build your kingdom here. We pray.
Unleash your kingdom's power. Reaching the near and far, no force of hell can stop
your beauty changing hearts.
You made us for much more than this.
Awake the kingdom seed in us.
Fill us with the strength
and love of Christ.
She's hospitalized in Sioux Falls, and she needs our prayer, so I just thought I would add that to the prayer list.
Thank you. Now may God bless you. May God shine his face upon you. May God give you his peace. And go out into this world knowing that the Holy Spirit goes with you. And that as disciples, it may be a step-by-step, small baby step process to help us in our denying of ourselves and our bearing of our crosses. But again, the Holy Spirit goes with us. And don't forget that. And don't forget that God is with you at all times in all things through anything and everything you may be experiencing in life. So go knowing that you're loved, going knowing that the peace of Christ goes with you as well. God bless you. We'll see you next week.